الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين، أما بعد، فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في محكم التنزيل: بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، إن تعدوا نعمة الله لا تحصوها، صدق الله العظيم. All praise be to Almighty Allah, and may He shower His choicest of peace and blessings upon His beloved Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and upon all those who follow His footsteps in the day of Qiyamah. Respected brothers and elders in Islam, before I start off with today's khutbah, first I would like to admonish myself and then to all of you with taqwa, to fear Allah in all circumstances. Respected brothers and elders in Islam, the verses of the Quran which I have recited before you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَإِن تَعُدُّوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا. If you are to count the favors, the bounties, the blessings which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed upon you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَا تُحْصُوهَا, you cannot count it. The blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala which He has given us are innumerable, we cannot give it a proper number. It is so much. So respected brothers, each one of us in our lives, we are enjoying so many blessings even though we don't understand. In another verse of the Holy Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Allah's blessings could be seen in your own selves. Why don't you see your own selves? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands us. If we take our own body or our physique, we see the nervous system which is running inside, the eyes we used to see, the ear we used to hear, the mind we used to think, each and everything shows that there is a creator behind it, and we are enjoying the benefits of those creations in ourselves. Respected brothers and elders in Islam, we cannot give a proper number to the ni'mat of Allah. For an instance, if we take, maybe we do not identify that this is a real ni'mat of Allah. For an example, early in the morning we wake up, and in the night we enjoy sleep. Nobody bothers to think about, am I going to have a very peaceful night or not? Will I have a sleep or not? Sleep is something which is enjoyed by everyone, and which is also a ni'mat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Respected brothers and elders in Islam, likewise, many bounties of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are enjoyed by us, but we have not understood the reality of it. So we can classify the ni'mats of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala into two. The first type are those ni'mats of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala which He had given to us without us asking for it. He has given it to us free of charge. So when we were in the womb of our mothers, none of us or nor our parents asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us two eyes, two legs, two hands and a heart to think and a brain. None of us. Likewise, respected brothers, so many things Allah has given us without us asking for it. It clearly proves that those are the blessings which Allah has given us without us even thinking of it. And number two is, those types of ni'mat which we have got after a few effort made by us. Maybe a house which we have built, maybe the occupation we are involving ourselves, the vehicle we have bought, all these things are blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala we have achieved through little bit of effort made by us. Respected brothers, if somebody was to come to us and he would say, I am ready to give a very valuable car, a vehicle, which is worth more than 50 million or whatever, he says. He says, it is so much worth, I am ready to give you the vehicle, but with the condition that I am going to remove two legs off. I am going to remove your two legs off and I am going to give you the vehicle. What is the answer going to be? None of us are going to say that I am prepared for that. So respected brothers, we see that the ni'mat which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us free of charge are far more valuable than the ni'mats which we are attaining through our effort. But out of all the blessings which Allah has given us, the greatest of blessing is the blessing to utter the kalima la ilaha illallah. The shahada and the iman and this tawheed is the greatest of ni'mat which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us. Rest of all the other ni'mat will come to an end. But when it comes to the kalima la ilaha illallah, this has not got an end. It is the prerequisite for a person to enter into Jannah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has honored us by granting us this ni'mat. On the day of Qiyamah, there will be so many kuffar who are disbelievers, who will be regretting that in the life of this world, if they have brought iman, that would have been enough for their salvation from the hellfire. So we thank Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for giving us this ni'mat of shahada and the tawheed. But my talk for today's khutbah would be, We are enjoying so many ni'mats, but Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam highlighted two blessings or two ni'mats which are generally neglected by the majority. In a hadith, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, ni'matani maghbunun feehima kathirun minan nas. There are two blessings which most of the people are careless about. So it covers the young, the old, the women, the men, everybody at large. He said, as-sihhatu wal-faragh. That is good health and your free time. So respected brothers and elders in Islam, let us see what Islam speaks when it comes to maintaining good health. As a Muslim, we must know that Islam is not a religion which only teaches us issues related to ibadah, how you should perform your salah, how you should perform your zakat and your hajj and so many ibadah. Islam is even more broader. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has taught us how we should have our meals and how we should maintain our health as well. So let me highlight a few things on that. Firstly, respected brothers and elders in Islam, health is one of the greatest bounties of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In Arabic they would say, a person understands the value of a bounty or a blessing only after he loses it. The moment he is deprived of it, now he starts to think, I have lost it, and he values that. For an example, a person enjoys good eyesight. He can see without using any spectacle or whatever. So he's enjoying good sight. But the moment when he feels that his sight is becoming weak day by day, now he starts to think about the days he used to enjoy the good sight. At times we would fall ill. Maybe all of a sudden we fall sick. And at that moment we will start thinking, when I was a very sound person, when I was healthy, I used to perform salah in the masjid, I was able to walk to the masjid. But now I have fallen sick and I am unable to walk to the masjid. So respected brothers, we understand the ni'mat the moment we are deprived of it. A person is habitually using a vehicle, the moment he finds the vehicle is not working or operating, at that moment he starts to realize the value of that particular vehicle. Likewise, respectable brothers and elders in Islam, health is one of the greatest ni'mat which we are enjoying. Imagine for a second, at this very moment, there will be so many thousands of people around the world who are bedridden. Maybe there was a young boy who was riding his motorcycle yesterday in the road in a very nice fashion with his friends. But all of a sudden he had to meet with an accident and he had to sacrifice and he had to amputate his leg. Allahu Akbar. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given him a blessing, but the moment he is deprived of that, he starts to regret. Likewise, so many thousands of people are living in coma. So many people are suffering from so many deadly diseases, leprosy and so on. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has protected us from that and has given us good health. Isn't health a valuable asset? It is. Likewise, respectable brothers and elders in Islam, that is why Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also gave lot of importance to good health. In a hadith of Tirmidhi, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was in the minbar and he said to the sahaba, Salullah al-afwa wal-afiyah. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness and ask Allah to give you good health. Ask Allah to give you good health. And after that he said, the best ni'mat after iman, after you have got the ni'mat of tawheed, the greatest of ni'mat is for you to enjoy good health. Allahu Akbar. You see, when a person enters Jannah, it is a place where people will be eating, it's a place where they will be enjoying themselves. But one of the first announcements to be made there, it will be said to them, you can live without any fear, you can have anything, you need not worry about your health, because forever you are going to be healthy, you are never going to fall ill. Allahu Akbar. So we can see that the ni'mat of health in this world also is important, and also in the akhirah Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has kept it for us. When we look into the teachings of Islam, when it comes to maintaining good health, from the five times salah which we perform, from there to each and every ibadah, purification is linked. For an example, if a person is performing his five daily prayers, that involves physical movement and plus he is mentally trained. His concentration is disciplined. When a person is observing his salah, both these things stay. So if a person is able to offer his salah in the correct manner, as Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if a person's salah is perfect, all his other a'mal are going to be perfect. Likewise, if a person's salah is not perfect, the rest of his deeds are also going to be at fault. So respected brothers and elders in Islam, firstly, when you see our day-to-day prayer, it has some relationship to health. And also we performing ablution before salah and keeping ourselves clean from najasa. It is a clear indication that Shariat advises us to be clean, so that by being clean, a person could maintain his good health. And thirdly, when it comes to one of the most a topic which is spoken very less, but which was highlighted by the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his Sahaba a lot. That is, respectable brothers and elders in Islam, it is the major part which is related to health. That is eating excessively, having food excess. We see Islam is a religion which has taught us moderation. When it comes to food habits, the Quran says, O you who believe, eat what is good from what we have provided you with. So that is a verse of the Quran which gives us clear indication. You can have any food as long as it is halal. But in another verse of the Holy Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Kulu washrabu wala tusrifu. You can eat and drink. You can eat and drink whatever you want. But with one condition, see that you are not extravagant. Generally what we speak about extravagance is wasting food. But the ulama write, when it comes to wasting food, something else also plays. That is, if a person is consuming a lot of food, even that will be coming under this exception made by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So eating in moderation is part of Shariat, but it is one of the most difficult things to be practiced in this zaman. We see, when a person is habitual to eating a lot, he is immune to many diseases. There is a risk that he might fall into diabetes, there is a risk that he might fall into heart attacks, and so many other diseases. But where the main reason was, he was eating excess, that is why he has got this. When you see the hadith of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam related to food, in the riwayat of Tirmidhi, he said, no human being has ever filled a utensil worse than his own belly. There isn't any utensil which was filled by the son of Adam worse than his own stomach. And thereafter Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, he said, it is enough for a person to consume food as long as he can keep his backbone straight. So we see Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is teaching us moderation. And thereafter he said, if you are unable to do so, if you really want to have your diets proper, he had guided us in the correct way. He said, if you really want to have it properly, you have one third of your food as solid and one third as liquid and one third as gas. Subhanallah. We see the scientists of today, they say it is sufficient for a person to fill one third of his stomach and leave the rest for drink and gas. We see our Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam 1400 years ago, he has already taught the Muslims, this is how you should conduct yourself when it comes to food. We see the root for most of the diseases is a person eats excessive. When we take our own bodies, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created in such a way that when it is time for it to quench the thirst, it will ask for water. And when it feels hungry, it needs some food inside. There's an alarm which goes, it says, I'm hungry, please put in something. But the moment we give extra, it says, it's overloaded. You're forcing me to do something which I cannot do anymore. In the long run, we see people falling into so many types of diseases. And one of the shuyukh of a shaykh in his book, Nihayatul Alam, he mentions a science of Qiyamah. He narrates a hadith in Bukhari. He says one of the signs of Qiyamah, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prophesies. He said, when the day of Qiyamah is approaching, you will find many people with large bellies. I'm not pinpointing at anybody, but this is what is mentioned in the hadith. So after that the shaykh writes, he says, the reason why Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said this is, the times we're living in today, the food habits have changed. Compared to the past, the food habits today have changed. So many restaurants, so many food outlets there. We see our Muslims, we see our youth. So many people are enjoying the fast food compared to the food we enjoy at home. But respected brothers and elders in Islam, the Shaykh, he writes in his book, he says, the main reason why Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said this verse, there will be so many different types and different delicacies will be introduced in the latter stages of the world, and those people will start enjoying that. And likewise, so many appliances will be invented in the world, people will not have time to work. They will not find time to walk. They will not have time to go on jihad. They will be busy in one place. They will be having their meals in one place. They will remain in the same place. Morning to evening they will be in one place. And end of the day what happens, it's prophesied by Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam that they will be people who will be very huge. So respectable brothers and elders in Islam, when I was preparing for this khutbah, I came across one of the incidents which Umar radiallahu anhu's view regarding obesity. We call it obesity in English. He came across a man, he was having a very huge belly, a stomach. He looked at him and he said, "What is this?" He said, "Barakatullah." The man replied, "Barakatullah." He said, "This is the blessing of Allah." When Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu heard this, he was upset. He said, "This is not the barakat of Allah, but this is the azab of Allah." Why did he mention azab, the punishment of Allah? The reason is, respectable brothers and elders in Islam, if a person is a habitual, his habit is to eat excessive, he becomes lethargic, he becomes lazy to perform the ibadat of Allah. He will not find the true taste in the ibadat. Because of that, he will become a prey for his lust and his wishes. Khalifa Umar radiallahu anhu disliked people with that sifat. So as Muslims, we must see that we should control our diet according to the way Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has taught us. And likewise, if we see the statistics of today in the world, this obesity has been affected. This is a disease which is prevalent everywhere, including our country. It is mentioned in statistics, 1/6 of the world are suffering from this. We see at times we have a very heavy meal after Jum'ah, and sometimes we fall prey to sleep. We surrender to sleep and we are unable to perform our Asr Salat with Jama'ah. Didn't the food have an impact on our ibadah? When we have a very heavy meal after a walima or a wedding function, we find it very difficult to wake up next day in the morning for Fajr. Didn't the food have an impact? Yes, it did. But when we see the food habits of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he ate moderately, he lived moderately, and we see he enjoyed the best, and he had the best of health. And the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they too enjoyed the best of health. And point number two in the hadith which I mentioned was regarding faragh. Faragh, it means leisure time. So the first ni'mat is health. As Muslims, we have to show concern regarding our health. And number two is regarding our free time. Some would compare time with gold. But that's wrong. The person was owning, he owns gold to the extent the size of this world. Even if he loses it, he can make some effort and get it back. But if a person loses 1 second of his life, even if he spends the whole world and whatever it contains, he cannot get that second back again. The time which has elapsed is past, and the time which is to come is what we are waiting for. So respected brothers and elders in Islam, Shaitan has deceived us, saying that you're very young. When it comes to youngsters, the Shaitan deceives us saying, you're very young, you have not seen the world yet, you didn't get married, you have not seen your children yet, you're not drawing a good salary so far you're not settled in life. There is time for you to become an adult, and there you settle your life, and then you think of ibadah. Some of the youth would say, I'm ready to sacrifice myself for the cause of Allah after I turn 40. Who has given us the guarantee that I'm going to live till 40 years? So many of our friends who are with us have passed away without any reason. All of a sudden the death had to come without prior notice, and they had to leave. Respectable brothers and elders in Islam, so the deception of Shaitan is that he says you're still young, there is more time. He never says don't do a'mal, but he says just postpone the deed. Maybe a person is interested in watching the cricket match, and he sees the time for Isha or a prayer comes, and he thinks it is just one over away for the match to finish, or there's few overs away, it will take only around half an hour, I can just watch the 2 hours and go back to the masjid. But respectable brothers and elders in Islam, the fact is that Shaitan is saying, don't pray now, but you can pray later. He never said, don't pray. So if we fall prey to Shaitan, we are in the trap and we are following his footsteps. May Almighty Allah protect us. On the day of Qiyamah, the kuffar, when they are entered into Jahannam, they have one they will request Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give them respite. They would say, Rabbana akhrijna na'mal salihan ghayra alladhi kunna na'mal. Ya Allah, we are suffering in this hellfire. Please take us out of this place and send us back to the world so that we can do good deeds, and we promise that we are not going to involve in the same sins we used to do. So they would say that. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would say, أَوَلَمْ نُعَمِّرْكُمْ مَا يَتَذَكَّرْ فِيهِ مَنْ تَذَكَّرْ. Did we not give you lives long enough so that whoever would receive admonition? We had given you enough time in this world for you to think and ponder and prepare yourself. But now you come for the hellfire and you're saying that you need time. And after that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the same ayah, وَجَاءَكُمُ النَّذِيرُ. When you lived in this world, there came to you warners who said that it's time for you to leave this world. Your time is approaching. But still yet, you are heedless. You didn't bother about those warnings given to you. But you lived a life on your free will. And end of the day, you have ended up in this hellfire. Allah should protect each one of us. Respected brothers and elders in Islam, the ulama write, what does the word nazir in this ayah refer to? What is the meaning of the word warner? Ulama have given three interpretations. One is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes reference to the anbiya and the salihin. There are so many people who call us towards good. Sometimes they come to our doorstep and they call us towards the masjid. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, this is also a warner to you. He came to you and reminded you, come to the masjid, become closer to Allah, become a friend of Allah. But you didn't have time. But now you're asking for time. And interpretation, the second interpretation is, if a person finds grey hair, it is a sign that death is approaching. If he finds grey hair, it is an indication that your time is up. And number three is, if a person sees his grandchildren, it is a sign for his death. So what does it mean? If the grandparents are enjoying the birth of a child, that child is saying, oh grandpa or grandma, it's time for you to leave, it is time for us to enjoy. That's the indication they're making for us. So respectful brothers and elders in Islam, this verse is in Surah Fatir. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions about this. Imagine if a person has a dialogue with a Malakul Maut. Mr. Taqi Usmani mentions this. He says, if Malakul Maut comes to one of us and he says, it's time for you to leave. And we have a discussion with him. We say, why did you come to me without giving me prior notice? In this world, we have everything before some notice. But why did you come without informing me? Malakul Maut would say, I did inform you. Didn't you remember the day you fell sick? You were having, you were fall ill, and you were bedridden, and you were relaxing at home. Didn't you know that one day is going to come that you're going to be weak like that? Didn't you see the grey hair in your beard? Didn't you see that? Didn't you see your grandchildren? You saw all of them. So I've given you enough notices, and it's now my time to take your soul. Allahu Akbar. So respectable brothers and elders in Islam, when you look into our lives, so many moments have passed. So many moments, including myself and all of us. We have missed so many opportunities to do good deeds. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if you say subhanallah, half the span of the scale is filled, the mizan. How long does it take to say subhanallah? It doesn't even take a second, it takes milliseconds. You do a good deed for a millisecond and Allah is rewarding you so much. But how far have we found the importance of every second which is passing in our life? Allahu Akbar. Ibn Hajar rahmatullahi alayhi, he was a great imam. He's the imam who wrote Fathul Bari, which is a commentary for Sahih al-Bukhari. He was one of the greatest imams in the annals of his history. When he used to write his kitab, when he was writing his book, they don't use the pens of what you use today. They used to have the reed pen. So this reed pen need to be sharpened after some time. So this imam, when he used to reshape the pen, he used to utter the kalima, Subhanallah, walhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah, wallahu akbar. And it was asked, he said, I don't want to waste this moment I spent to sharpen my reed pencil. Allahu Akbar. The time, the importance given by the Salafus Saleh for the time was such that we cannot imagine, we cannot compare ourselves with them. There were some a'imma, they would write kitabs, they would write books, and they will have the pages separately. So when visitors come to meet them, While they talk to the visitor, at the same moment they would start binding. So they had separated time for binding? No. They used to utilize the time while they're talking to a visitor, they used to bind the books. You see the importance given by them to time. But when it comes to our case, in today, so many youth, vacations are starting in schools and so many places. The sad part to see, you know, youth would say, we kill time, we kill time. They take pride by saying that. So many youth are involved in social media. They spend hours and hours and hours. They sit after prayers or in their mobile phones. So many hours of the day is spent. Some spend 6 hours, 8 hours, 10 hours, merely in the social media. If you ask them, what did you gain through that? End of the day, he hasn't gained anything. So if he was to calculate the number of hours he spent throughout the week, he would see, or end of the month, he would see he had spent days in front of his computer screen. He had spent days in front of his mobile phone. The youth of today, very few of them have understood the value of time. So we need to admonish them, we need to advise them that time is very valuable. Because maybe you are in your teenage, you are enjoying your mobile phone. A day is going to come that your friends are going to leave you and they will go up in life. But when you turn in 25, 26, now you want to settle in life, you see the friends who were with you when you were 16 are no longer there. Those friends who used to chat with you are no longer there. Now it's up to you to find your own path. When we stick ourselves to the ways of Sharia, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would really give us the correct guidance. And also at times we feel like doing good deeds and we find it very lazy. Maybe tonight before we sleep, we will have the niyat that I'm going to perform tahajjud tomorrow in the morning. But when the alarm starts to work, you know, it starts to ring, and then you think, no, I think it's better I pray tomorrow. I'm feeling tired today. I step late, so I think it's better for me to sleep tomorrow, better for me to pray tomorrow. But respect of brothers and elders in Islam, imagine if the president of this country or the king of some place is to invite us to give us a gift. He wants to award us with something. Do you think that we will stay behind? Will you tell him that, okay, it's all right, I know I'm going to get a gift for that, but just keep it reserved, I'll come some other time and I will take it. You will say that? No. We will value the gift that king is going to give us. But the king of all kings, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is waiting to give us Jannah. You stay awake at night, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking us, you can enter Jannah without any problem. But we're saying, it's all right, we know that we can go to Jannah, but just give us some time. Tomorrow I'll perform my tahajjud. But respectful brothers and elders in Islam, we need to bring the importance of a'mal in our life, and we used to utilize that. When you go to a maqbara of today, the qabristan, the graveyard, if you are to ask those people, how has Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala behaved with you? What was the outcome of your result? What was your result end of the day? Are you from Jannah or Jahannam? One of the things which those people in the grave are desiring even today is the moment you pray two rakats of salah. The two rakahs we are praying nafil after every salat, for example, that salat is more valuable to them. That is more valuable to them than this whole world and whatever it contains. We see, when we go to the maqbara, we would see so many graveyards, thousands of graveyards. So many graves. There was an alim who was buried. After 10-15 years, there was a madman who was buried. After another 10-15 years, a professional person was buried. After another 15-20 years, a mufti was buried. This is the life of dunya, brothers. If I am buried in my grave, a few years later, when they exhume my grave, I won't be there. There will be another person who will be buried. This is the reality of life. If we can understand the true value of time, I think each and every second in our life will be spent in the correct manner. That's why Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, before five things occur, make use of five things. Irtanim khamsan qabla khamsin. He said, shababaka qabla haramik. Make use of your youth before you become old. You ask the old men, how do you feel when you pray seated on the chair? They would say, I like to stand in the saf just like you, but today I'm not feeling well, that's why I'm seated. Respectable brothers and elders in Islam, today we can stand in the saf and perform our salat in the correct way, but a time is going to come that we'll be sitting on a chair, we'll be seated down, we'll be leaning on something. When we become weak, we'll understand. That is why one of the Arabic books they write, there was a very old man, very aged person who was walking the streets, and he sees a few young boys playing. He had a very hunchback, he had a bent back because of his very old age. So one of those boys playing there, he just wanted to make a mockery of it. He said, oh uncle, from where did you get that bent back? That old man, he was very wise. He didn't lose his temper. He said, oh my son, don't worry. The time is going to come. Don't ask me from where did I buy it. You're going to get it for free. That age is going to come, but before that age comes, each one of us to prepare ourselves. Number two, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, make use of your health before you become ill. Make use of your wealth before you become poor. Make use of your free time before you become busy. And make use of your life before your death. When we compare the past with the today's times, to prepare a cup of tea, Mufti Taqi Usmani mentions this, says, to prepare a cup of tea, you had to spend half an hour to get the firewood, to burn, to get the kerosene, do all sorts of things. You had to burn, get the utensil, wash it, go to the well, fetch some water. You get a cup of tea after half an hour of hard work. But today we're living. Within 2 minutes, we have the cup of tea in front of us. Those days, people who used to go to Hajj, maybe the seniors who are here, they will know. Though they used to spend months and months in Hajj. For example, maybe if a person has to travel for 1 month all the way to Makkah from here, for an example. But today we can fly to Makkah within 6 to 7 hours. For Mufti Taqi Usmani poses a question. What happened to the 28 minutes which we saved from preparing tea? What happened to the 29 days which we saved from traveling to Makkah? Where are those 29 days? Where are those 28 minutes in our lives? So many things have become so easy for us. We need to communicate to somebody, just need to take the mobile phone out and just ring and you say, I'm not coming today. But there was a time we had to go all the way there and inform him that I'm not going to come. So respect of brothers and elders in Islam, the world we're living today has become advanced. Why has it become advanced? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it advanced. The Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I have created the horses, I have created the mules, I have created the so many animals, he mentioned that. And he says, I'm going to create things which you don't know. He speaks to the Sahaba, he's addressing the Sahaba. Did the Sahaba ever see a vehicle? No. Did they see a plane flying? No. Allah says, I'm going to create things which you don't know. The time we are living today is far away from those. We hardly find people using camels and donkeys and horses for their rides. No. We use vehicles. It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made the world advanced. But why did He make it like that? He has given us enough time. He says, I have given you enough time. So utilize your time. Make it, use it in a very proper, very useful manner so that you can find the true peace in this world and the hereafter. Finally, how could we make our time useful? How could we spend it in the proper way? Number one, respectable brothers and elders in Islam, ikhlas should come into our lives. Whatever we do, maybe we are earning something, we have a shop, we are working in an office, maybe we work in a masjid, we are doing some service to the community, whatever. Just have the intention, Ya Allah, I am doing this for your sake. It is my responsibility to, you have asked me to quench the thirst of my family. That's what I'm doing it, because it is your order. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would reward us for that. And number two, remember Allah to your best of your ability. Maybe we're driving the car. We know a few surahs which we have memorized. Maybe the full surahs. You can just read them. In a hadith, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the one who reads Qul huwallahu ahad 10 times, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will build a palace for him in Jannah. How long is it going to take? We're traveling, we are in the bus, just seated there, we are not talking to anybody, we are not doing any zikr. We can read this Qul huwallahu ahad 10 times and we can have the ihtisab, expecting the reward. Ya Allah, you're building a palace for me in paradise. That's why I'm going to read this now. Umar radiallahu anhu, when he heard this hadith, he said to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya Rasulallah, then I would recite this surah abundantly. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replied, even if you recite it abundantly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will likewise give you abundant number of palaces. Allahu Akbar. Easy deeds. Where could it take us? It can increase our daraja in this world and the hereafter. Number three, most of us are involved in business and trade and stuff, so we maintain a profit and loss account. We see the expenditure, we see the income. Brothers, why do we do that in this world? Because we know the value of money. Because we value money, we have a profit and loss account for money. But from today onwards, if we can have a firm intention, determination, that I'm going to have a same profit and loss account for my time. Umar radiallahu anhu said, Hasibu anfusakum qabla an tuhasabu. Make account of your own self. Don't make account about others. Make account of your own self. Before there is a time that you will be made, when you will be asked for questions. Allah is going to ask us on the day of Qiyamah. Each one of us are going to stand in the court of Allah and going to give answers to these questions. Before we do that, why don't we start examining our own selves? How did I spend my day today? What was the profit I got in this day? Did I pray my tahajjud? Did I behave in the correct way? Did I conduct my trade in the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked me? Maybe if there's a shortcoming, if there are shortcomings in that, we can do istighfar. Allah will forgive us. And finally, the best medicine is to perfect our salah. As Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, I mentioned the hadith to you, is to perform our salah in such a manner that we should understand, we must think that the salah which I am going to perform now is the final salah in my life. If salah is perfect, everything of our life will become perfect. If we can perfect this salah, so who knows, this is the final Jummah we are going to pray in our lives. Allahu Alam will be alive till the prayer is about to be started. We don't know. There are so many people who started to call Adhan before they finished the Adhan, the roof was taken. There are so many people who gave the right side salam before they gave the left, the roof was taken. There are so many people who went to sujood but they came back. They didn't come back to the julus by a sajda thing. So mouth doesn't come with notice. So we need to prepare for it. So whenever we perform our salah, think that this is the final salah in my life. So I need to perform it in such a way to my best of my ability. The sunnah, the wajibat, everything perfectly performed, Allah will accept it and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make our lives perfect. We ask Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those who value the blessings that He has given us, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the ni'mat, and may He not take away the ni'mat which He has given us due to our sins and due to our shortcomings. Wa akhir da'wana and alhamdulillah.